Welcome to a new edition of the Neon Jazz Interview Series with Toronto-based trombonist, composer, and educator William Cam. He spoke on behalf of the band about their latest 2017 release, Carn Davidson's Nines, Murphy. This Toronto-based nonet was formed at the beginning of 2010 as a collaborative project to reimagine their compositions, giving a new perspective on their existing repertoire. They have a grand history and big plans for the future, so get to know this interesting band and dig this interview, my friends.
Thank you for taking a minute out to talk about the band and the new album, Murphy, and I'm looking forward to talking with you about it.
Sure, thank
you. Cool. So let me go ahead and start off here. I got the album. It's a great listen, and I want to know what you think about Cam Davidson 9, the album Murphy. Give me kind of an idea of what went into this album.
Well, this is our second, our sophomore release. So since the band started, 8 years ago, I believe, the band's gotten better, like as it should, over 8 years. And the repertoire is different and in some ways, again, better. Tara and I feel overall this is a much better representation of the band and the music. Everything seemed to be just heading in the right direction. So spent a couple of days in the studio, laid down all the track. We also were lucky enough to get it with 9 people, you know, and these are some of the best players in Toronto. It's hard to get everybody together, but we were able to get 3 days together before the recording to just hang out and play. And it all just kind of worked out.
So you guys, as a nonet, have been together since 2010. You kind of came together to reimage compositions. Talk to me about how the beginnings of this band started and kind of what your vision was as such a large outfit in jazz.
Sure. Tara and I both had small ensembles, quartets, quintets, and the like. The idea for this band came up actually because there was a local festival called us up. And asked if we had any ideas for a new project. And at the time, I was listening to this John Scofield record called Quiet, and I loved the record, and the whole concept of that record was he has this trio, you know, Steve Swallow, and I think it was Bill Stewart on bass, and but he didn't really comp much on the whole record. The whole record was, he was supported by a wind ensemble. And that sound just kind of knocked me out, even though he's a guitarist, but he was basically just playing melody and taking solos. So these arrangements really had to fulfill the background as well as sometimes taking the melody. All of that stuff, all the harmonic stuff that a pianist or a guitar player would supply. So that's basically where the idea for this band came from, for us to play our original songs, but taking the harmonic instrument out of the mix. So then the arrangements, we have added challenge as an arranger to cover backgrounds and provide some of the chordal stuff that a pianist or guitar would play.
With such a large group of people together, and you guys are all very talented and you guys have a lot of history together, how does everything come together in such a seamless fashion to make the sound you make? How do you all intermingle so well?
Oh, I think a big part of it, of course, is chemistry, personal and musical. Like everybody in the band, we've had and continue to have a musical, if not a personal, relationship with. There's been a couple of changes in the band from the first CD. Our drummer moved to New York City. And then the current drummer, Ernesto Cervini, we play in his sextet, Tara's known him since, you know, they were like kids. And the bass trombonist as well changed because our previous bass trombonist got busy. So the current bass trombonist, Alex, was actually a former student of mine at the University of Toronto. And he sounds so good, and we thought, well, you know, that'd be really cool to kind of, I've seen him since he was in high school up until now, and now I get to hire him, you know, as part of my band. So I thought that was pretty cool. And then everybody else we work with on a constant basis in different big bands and different ensembles, the shows and all of that. So we've all been playing together really for a very long time. Just in this configuration, it's been, I guess, 7 years now. So
future of this band? What do you see as kind of the eventual, you know, the current path, and as you go into the future, what do you guys want to do?
We actually have plans right now. We're booking a tour for, I mean, you got to book so far in advance, but we're looking at September of 2018 as a Canadian tour right now. We've actually, we have like 8 dates so far. The challenge, of course, is funding, and because it's so many people, hard to bring everybody across the country. So Tara and I looked at, well, what do we need, essentially? So we decided we're going to take the 5 of the 9. So we're going to take our lead trumpet player, myself, Tara, and the bass and drum, the rhythm section. And then we're playing at in major city centers, and we know there's great musicians in each place, so we're going to hire local musicians. And that way we get to play with the locals, and, you know, instead of, we all know each other by name and all that on Facebook, but we never actually get to make music with the musicians across the country. So we're going to take this as an opportunity to kind of play our music and also get to play with the local players, and hopefully they can help bring out an audience as well. So that's the next plan.
You know, I'm going to kind of ask you, because we're, you know, this is hyper-local and we're talking about it, but kind of as a band, why do you love jazz?
Oh, my God. Well, you know what? I have a few thoughts about that. I mean, I actually started out as a classical musician. I was classically trained. I went to the University of Toronto, and you know, I was playing in orchestras and all of that. But my love of jazz started from, like so many musicians, from a really good teacher. So I was in high school, and I had a very inspirational teacher who was a classical flautist, but she loved jazz, and she loved classical music. So she never picked a side. She wasn't a snob. So she was playing at the same time as playing us symphonies and all that in school, and she took us to, you know, to hear the Toronto Symphony here in the city. She also started, when I was in high school, Wynton Marsalis was just, like, coming out. He was just, like, the hot thing. So she was playing us all of his classical and jazz recordings, and that's where it started. It was like that kind of being, okay, you know, it's all amazing music. It's just different sides of, you know, different musical personalities. So that's where it started for me. And then the aspect of improvisation was so liberating, so frightening, of course, in the beginning, but there was something that you don't get in classical music, you know, especially being a trombone player. I mean, I could sit there for an hour and not play a note and then have to play 3 notes and nail it. And so it's a different kind of a musical experience than playing jazz in a big band or certainly in a small ensemble. I think between all of that and the pursuit of just the virtuosity of being a jazz musician, you know, the dexterity on your instrument, all those challenges lumped in together, I think, just make the music. That's why it's so vital to me and, you know, all of my colleagues, I'm sure.
Well, let me up the ante a little bit here, and let me ask you this. Everyone has a version of who you all are as a band. You're a big outfit. There's a lot of people, a lot of personalities, a lot of talents that go into this. But let me ask you this. Everyone's going to have a perception, your family, your friends, and your fans. But who do you all think you are? When you guys, if you had to sell yourself to get a gig, how would you describe who you guys are? Who do you guys personally think you are as an outfit?
Oh, my gosh. You're asking some great questions. tough questions. This is the first. I've never been asked this question before. Who do we think we are? Well, I think that's a really tough one. I mean, the crux of the band is about playing our music, our original composition. So in some ways, it's a very personal expression of ourselves. It's not like we're sitting there and we're playing, you know, classic swing big band music, which represents something. It represents entertainment and dancing and all this. So in this respect, the band, our band, is actually our artistic expression of our musician's life. I mean, because I'm a freelance musician 90% of the time. Even though I play in other people's jazz ensembles and all that, I'll play with shows. I'm playing with an orchestra on this Saturday, you know. And that's all fantastic, and I love it. But this band represents something that's it's the most personal expression of what we do right now, currently, you know, for Tara and myself, because this is the place where we're playing our music the way we want to play it. And the players we pick, we feel like they're also the most, they get that. They're able to express the music we want expressed. Does that make sense?
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah. Like, I remember years ago, I played a show with, here in the city. Maria Schneider was an artist in residence at a college I teach at. And so the faculty big band was playing her music, and I was so impressed with how detailed and meticulous she wouldn't just gloss over any, it's like, it said forte, okay, we just play loud. No, she wanted the forte this way, it's this section of this piece. But forte meant something else in another section. So when the music is, you know, when you've written the music, even though we didn't arrange all the music, but we know how, you know, the purpose behind each song and what we're trying to express, if you get nine people together that can do that well as one unit, you know, there's really nothing more satisfying than that.
Beautiful. I think that's a great way to wrap everything up. Hey, thanks for taking a little time out to talk about the band. Thank you for the music, and I'm looking forward to putting it on the show for sure.
Man, thank you so much. You're really great questions.
Thanks for listening and tuning in to yet another Neon Jazz interview, where we give you a bit of insight into the finest players in Toronto, Kansas City, and spots all over the world, giving fans all that jazz. And thanks to William for his time, his music, and his stories. If you want to hear more interviews, go to Famous Interviews with Joe Dimino on the iTunes Store. Visit neonjazz@youtube.com. And for everything Neon Jazz, go to the neonjazz.blogspot.com. Until next time, enjoy the music, my friends.
Neon Jazz.